अस्सलाम वालेकुम, आई एम डॉक्टर मोहम्मद लतीफ, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ऑफ मेडिसिन, वेलकमिंग स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ फोर्थ ईयर मेडिसिन फॉर टुडेज लेक्चर. टुडे आई विल बी डिलीवरिंग यू अ लेक्चर ऑन हिमोलिटिक एनीमियास. द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स आर एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल बी एबल टू नो द कॉजेज ऑफ एनीमिया, द इम्पॉर्टेंट हिस्ट्री क्वेश्चंस एंड हाउ टू इन्वेस्टिगेट the case of hemolytic anemia, the complications of the hemolytic anemias, and finally the treatment of the hemolytic anemias. The common causes of hemolytic anemias are: number one, the comb test positive autoimmune hemolytic anemias, which include drug induced, in which there is formation of RBC antibodies to RBC membrane. The commonest example is penicillin. And secondly, there are production of immune complexes. The classical example of immune complex production is the drug quinine. The autoimmune hemolytic anemias, second class, there are autoantibodies and their formation of autoantibodies against the RBC membrane and the hemolysis extravascular, and the cells may assume the shape as spherocytes. The types of the autoimmune hemolytic anemias are warm autoimmune hemolytic anemias, and they are usually IgG mediated, and there is bonding of the IgG immunoglobulins at body temperature 37 degree centigrade, which is the optimal temperature for the binding or bonding of the immunoglobulins to the cell surface. And mostly they are idiopathic, but other causes like lymphoproliferative disorders, which include CLL or chronic lymphocytic leukemia, lymphoma, SLE, and drugs. The treatment of the warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia is steroids, immunosuppressive agents, and splenectomy. The cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia is also IgG mediated, and the binding is at the temperature 4 degrees centigrade, but it is through the activation of the cell surface complement, meaning thereby that the complement and IgG, they lyse the cells. The causes are mycoplasma and EBV infections. Presentation of the cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia is that the patient presents with slowly progressive chronic anemia, and the patient may present to you also with the acrocyanosis and Raynaud's phenomena. Treatment of the cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia is that you keep the patient warm, and the chlorambucil offers some help to the patients of cold autoimmune hemolytic anemias. The next, paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. It is a kind of hemolytic anemia in which the causes are viruses, syphilis, and mechanism is formation of Donnet-Lanz-Jenner antibodies to RBCs in the cold. It is also mediated by the complement, and finally there is hemolysis on rewarming. And the patient attempts to dewarm, having gone outside into the cold, there is lysis or hemolysis of the cells. Its one variety is isoimmune type, and which follows acute transfusion reactions, and there is hemolysis in the newborn babies. The comb test negative autoimmune hemolytic anemias, totally 2% of all cases of autoimmune hemolytic anemia is its incidence, and the commonest example of the comb test negative autoimmune hemolytic anemia is autoimmune hepatitis, a very difficult disease to treat. Some patients are steroid responders, others are non-steroid responders, and it is of prime importance. The other causes are hepatitis B and C, and also flu can cause comb negative hemolytic anemia. Similarly, following the vaccinations for some diseases the patient can develop Coombs negative hemolytic anemias. And finally, the Coombs negative autoimmune hemolytic anemia can also be produced or caused by the drugs like piperacillin and rituximab, which is commonly used as a DMARD for the treatment of the rheumatoid arthritis. Next, hemolytic anemia is MAHA. The name is indicative of microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. In MAHA, the microvessels are functionally and structurally defunct or dysfunctional. They cause mechanical damage to the RBCs, but the difference is the hemolysis is intravascular. When you check the CBC, there will be formation or appearance of the schistocytes on the peripheral film. The causes of the microangiopathic hemolytic anemias are hemolytic uremic syndrome, thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, preeclampsia, eclampsia, and prostatic heart valve diseases. These are the schistocytes. You see, in schistocytes, these are the schistocytes. Their appearance is as if half of the cup has been cut and the upper part is gone and the lower part is remaining. So remember that the schistocyte, whenever you suspect you find schistocytes in CBC or peripheral film, you should always visualize that the patient might be suffering from hemolytic uremic syndrome, TTP or DIC. The malarial infections can also cause hemolytic anemias, and there is RBC lysis as already discussed, and the commonest example of the malarial infection is cerebral malaria or black water fever, in which there is hemoglobin urea and the patient passes Coca-Cola colored urine. All of a sudden, when the patient presents to you saying that I was suffering from the fever and now I am passing the Coca-Cola colored urine, you should always think of that the patient might not be a case of cerebral malaria and the falciparum variety of the malaria is responsible. All other infections, remember, do have the ability or capability of producing or exacerbating the hemolysis. Parvovirus is one of the commonest example which produces hemolysis. It also reduces the marrow erythropoiesis and producing aplastic anemia, but there are no reticulocytes in the circulation. See, in this patient, this is a normal colored urine and this is a black water urine in bottle C, and this is a diluted black water urine C. The color difference there is, this is a normal one, this is a black, and this is a maroon colored urine because of dilution. Next variety of the hemolytic anemia is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. The name is indicative that it occurs at night and it is paroxysmal. I mean, not a gradually progressing disorder. It attacks the patient in paroxysms or attacks, and usually at night. The patient goes to sleep, and when he wakes up in the morning, he says that I am passing the Coca-Cola colored urine, and the patient is a suspected case of paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. It is an acquired stem cell disorder and hemolysis at night. There is hemoglobin urea. There is finally the marrow failure, and the patient may also be complicated by thrombophilia. When you do the laboratory examination, there is in urine, there is hemosiderin urea. And flow cytometry is another test which detects the cells and the antigens on the cell surfaces. Treatment is anticoagulation and monoclonal antibodies, and finally the stem cell transplantation. Hereditary hemolytic anemias, most common example is glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency, which is X-linked recessive disorder, and there is the because of the enzyme defect, there is hemolysis. Normally, in normal situations or normal circumstances, there is no hemolysis, but when there is some oxidative crisis and low glutathione production, which is precipitated by the drugs, primarily the primaquine, sulfonamides, aspirin, and exposure to broad beans or favism. It is commonly found in the regions of Mediterranean, Africa, Middle East, and Far East. Now, practically, the G6PD deficiency hemolytic anemia is found when some patient comes to you with the fever and you offer the patient the sulfonamide. The commonest example is Ceftron, is a drug which is a sulfonamide. Similarly, you offer anti-malaria drug for the fever, but the patient develops hemolytic anemia. So you should be suspicious of that the patient might have got a deficiency of the G6PD, and which is a cause of the hemolytic anemia. The patient presents with rapid anemia and jaundice. When you check the CBC, there are white cell and blister cells in the peripheral film, but the enzyme level or enzyme assay is positive after the eight weeks. So you have to rely mostly on the lab film. Now, as you see, these are the blister shaped cells and these are the white cell in which some portion of the RBC is bitten. That is why the name is white cell. So whenever you see a CBC and you find that the patient, the histopathologist is reporting, hematologist is reporting that the peripheral film shows white cell and blister cells, you should at once be careful that the patient might be a case of the G6PD deficiency. Treatment, avoid HINA and the drugs which are the positive agents, and transfusion helps the patient because it is a rapidly developing anemia accompanied by jaundice. Pyruvate kinase deficiency anemia is also another enzyme defect. It is an autosomal recessive disorder. There is low ATP production. The RBC survival is poor, and the patient presents to neonatal jaundice in the early life, but late jaundice is also may be found, and the patient may have splenomegaly as well along with the jaundice. The lab test is again the enzyme assay, and the treatment is splenectomy, which is sometimes required in pyruvate kinase deficiency enzyme defect. Now, membrane defect. The commonest example is hereditary spherocytosis. It is an autosomal dominant disorder. It is Coombe negative, and the hemolysis is extravascular. The spherocytes have the poor capability of swimming through the vessels of the blood vessels, and they are less deformable. Therefore, on repeated attempts of bile passing on the capillaries, at frequent sites they get attached to the endothelial membrane and they get damaged and they get lysis and they are destroyed finally in the spleen. The common features of the hereditary spherocytosis are jaundice, splenomegaly, and bilirubin gallstones. The laboratory investigation includes the patient will be having on CBC low HB, and there will be reticulocytes 5 to 6%, and the patient will also be having on LFT examination unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. These are the spherocytes, sphere shaped, and they have the poor capability of deforming and passing through the vessels, and therefore they get lysed. Now, these are the bilirubin gallstones, looking like bilirubin, and they are a hallmark feature of this defect. Now, hereditary elliptocytosis. It is also an autosomal dominant disorder. The patient is usually asymptomatic, but fortunately the hereditary elliptocytosis patients have protection from the malaria. 1% have severe disease and they die in the utero. The treatment is folate supplements. Spleenectomy is sometimes required, but it is curative one. These are the elliptocytes, and they also have the poor capability of sailing through the capillaries, and finally they are destroyed in the spleen. Thalassemias. They are the genetic diseases in which there is unbalanced hemoglobin synthesis, and as a result there is underproduction or no production of one globin chains, and the alpha globin chains, which are the unmatched globins, they precipitate and they damage and cause lysis of the RBCs in the marrow. Thalassemias are common in Mediterranean, ranging from Mediterranean to the Far East. Hemoglobin review. Summarily, you know, each complex consists of 4 polypeptide chains and 4 heme complexes with iron bound and 4 oxygen binding sites. The normal adult hemoglobin A has 97% alpha 2 beta 2 chains, and HbA2 is only 2.5%, and it has got alpha 2 and delta 2 chains, and HbF is only 0.5%, and it has got alpha 2 and gamma 2 chains. The early embryo begins with alpha, gamma, epsilon and zeta chains, and at about 10 weeks the epsilon and zeta are replaced by alpha, beta and gamma chains. Near birth, beta replaces gamma and a small amount of 6 globin delta is produced. So now you see this is the sign for zeta, this is for delta, this is for epsilon, this is for gamma, this is for beta and alpha. These one you already remember, but the difficult ones are epsilon, delta and zeta chains. Now this is the hemoglobin structure. You see, the I already described. Simply look at the have a look at this hemoglobin structure and remember it. Globin chains. Now alpha globin, it has got 141 amino acids. Coding is on chromosome number 16. It is found in normal adult hemoglobin A1 and A2. Beta globins have 146 amino acids. Coding is done on chromosome number 11. It is found in hemoglobin A1. Delta globins, they are found in hemoglobin A2 in very small amounts in adults. Gamma globin is found in fetal hemoglobin, and zeta globin is found in embryonic hemoglobin. It has an importance which will be told to you later on. Now you see the hemoglobin types. Hemoglobin A1 is 92%. The chains are globin chains are alpha 2 and beta 2, and hemoglobin A2 is 2.5%, and the chains are alpha 2 and delta 2, and fetal hemoglobin is only 0.5 to 1%, and the chains are alpha 2 and gamma 2, and hemoglobin H is beta 4 chains, and Bart's hemoglobin is gamma 4 chains, and sickle hemoglobin is alpha 2 beta 2, but there is a substitution of the amino acid at position number 6, and valine replaces the glutamic acid. Similarly, in hemoglobin C, the chains are alpha 2 and beta 2. Again, here is a substitution of the amino acid at the same number, and the lysine replaces the glutamic acid. Genetics. Alpha globins are coded on chromosome 16, already told. 2 genes on each chromosome, 4 genes in each diploid cell, and gene deletion result in alpha thalassemia. Remember, I have used the word gene deletions result in alpha thalassemias. The also on chromosome 16 are zeta globin genes, which is a Gower hemoglobin or embryonic hemoglobin. Beta globins are coded on chromosome number 11, one gene on each chromosome, two genes on each diploid cell, and there is point mutation results in beta thalassemia. Now go back, and I use the word gene deletions result in alpha thalassemias. I again repeating, gene deletions result in alpha thalassemias and point mutations result in beta thalassemias. Also on chromosome 11 are delta, which is found in hemoglobin A2, and gamma, which is found in hemoglobin F or fetal hemoglobin, and epsilon, which is found in embryonic hemoglobin. Alpha thalassemias results from gene deletions already discussed. One deletion, the patient is a silent carrier, no clinical significance. Two deletions, alpha thalassemia trait, the patient is suffering from mild hyperchromic microcytic anemia. And when there are three deletions, the hemoglobin is known as HbH, and it is of variable severity but less severe than the beta thalassemia major. Four deletions, the condition will be known as Bart's hemoglobin or hydroxyphosphatidylase. Clinical condition will be hydroxyphosphatidylase. In hydroxyphosphatidylase, it is a serious fetal condition defined as in which there is abnormal accumulation of fluid in all fetal compartments, including ascites, pleural effusion, pericardial effusion, and skin edema. In some patients, it also may be associated with polyhydramnios and placental edema. Alpha thalassemia is continuing. Usually no treatment indicated in mild varieties and trait varieties, but four deletions are incompatible with life. Three or more deletions, reverse one. Three or fewer deletions have only mild anemia. Beta thalassemias, they result from point mutations on the genes. The severity depends on where the hits or mutation lies. Beta zero, no globin synthesis. Beta one positive, reduced synthesis. And the disease results in an overproduction of alpha thalassemia, alpha globin chains, which precipitates in the cells and causes splenic sequestration of RBCs. I again repeat, when there is absence of the beta globin chains, there is overproduction of alpha globin chains, which precipitate in the cells and cause splenic sequestration in the RBCs. And erythropoiesis increases, sometimes it is extramedullary as well. Now in beta thalassemia minor, there is a minor point mutation, there is minimal anemia clinically, and usually no treatment will be indicated. In beta thalassemia intermedia, it is homozygous and minor point mutation, and the heterozygous type presents more severe form. Most often they do not require chronic transfusions, but the beta thalassemia major or Cooley's anemia, beta thalassemia major or Cooley's anemia, there is severe gene mutation. They need careful observation and intensive management or treatment. Now in beta thalassemia major, there is reduced or non-existent production of beta globins. I again repeat, there is reduced or non-existent production of beta globin genes, beta globins. The oxygen carrying capacity of the RBC is poor, the patient fails to thrive, and there is poor brain development. And alpha globins increase production, precipitation results in RBC, and RBC precursors are destroyed within the marrow. Increased splenic destruction of dysfunctional RBCs also occurs, and the patient presents clinically with anemia, jaundice, and splenomegaly as usual, a feature of the hemolytic anemias. While continuing, there will be hyperplastic bone marrow in beta thalassemia major, and there will be, but unfortunately, the erythropoiesis will be ineffective and RBC precursor will be destroyed. There will be poor bone growth, frontal washing, and bony pains. And in addition, there will be extramedullary erythropoiesis. And in the circulation, the patient will be having iron overload because of the increased absorption and multiple transfusions while the patient is being treated for the beta thalassemia major, because these patients, they need the transfusion right from the 1 to 2 years of life. And the patient in addition will be also having endocrinopathies, and the endocrines which may be complicated or implicated in the beta thalassemia major may be pituitary gland, may be thyroid gland, may be pancreas, etc. And in addition, the myocardium is also involved producing cardiomyopathy, and the patient may also liver involvement may occur, and the hemochromatosis may occur, or finally the CLD or liver failure may ensue. On CBC, there will be hypochromic microcytic anemia, and in addition, the peripheral film will be showing target cell, nucleated RBC, anisocytosis, and reticulocytosis. HB electrophoresis is an authoritative diagnostic tool, and there will be increased hemoglobin A2, in which there is delta globin production, and increase hemoglobin F, which means that the gamma globin production is more. And on LFT checkup, there will be hyperbilirubinemia, and usually the bilirubin is unconjugated, a feature of the hemolysis. TFT function, TFT function abnormalities are a late finding, and the patient may be suffering from hyperglycemia. It is also a late finding when the thalassemia becomes chronic and the endocrines are involved, and the pancreas is also an endocrine organ. Therefore, patient will be developing diabetes mellitus as a late finding. Similarly, the growth hormone abnormality and thyroid function abnormalities will also be a late finding, not in the early part of the beta thalassemia. Now you see peripheral film in the beta thalassemia major will be showing you the target cells, like targets and teardrop cells. So remember that when you get a film, blood film, saying or mentioning that there are target cells or teardrop cells, you should also think of that the patient might not be suffering from the beta thalassemia major. Now the treatment of the बीटा थैलासीमिया यू स्टार्ट विद द ट्रांसफ्यूजन थेरेपी यूजली 2 to 4 weekly. द बेनिफिट्स ऑफ द ट्रांसफ्यूजन आर दैट द पेशेंट्स ग्रोथ इज मैक्सिमाइज एंड डेवलपमेंट इज नॉट डिलेड एंड इट ऑल्सो सप्रेसिस द पेशेंट्स ओन इनइफेक्टिव डिसफंक्शनल डिफंक्ट एरिथ्रोपोइसिस एंड ऑल्सो इट सप्रेसिस द ओवर एब्जॉर्प्शन ऑफ द आयरन फ्रॉम द गट एंड आरबीसी पैक सेल मे ऑल्सो बी गिवन टू द पेशेंट्स हु हैव लो हीमोग्लोबिन दे आर टिपिकली यूज इन एनीमिया दैट इज आइदर रिजल्टिंग इन सिम्टम्स और वैन द हीमोग्लोबिन इज लेस दैन 7 to 8 gram पर डेसीलीटर बट इट इज दे आर ऑफर्ड पैक सेल्स आर ऑफर्ड मंथली टू मेंटेन द हीमोग्लोबिन अराउंड 10 gram पर डेसीलीटर कीलेशन थेरेपी और पॉपुलरली नोन एज आयरन कीलेशन थेरेपी इट बाइंड्स द फ्री आयरन एंड रिड्यूसेस द हीमोसिड्रिन डेपोजिशन डेस्फेरिओक्सामिन इज द आयरन कीलेटिंग एजेंट इट इज ऑफर्ड इन द फॉर्म ऑफ इन्फ्यूजन 5 nights per week बट देर इज ए रिस्क ऑफ यर्सिनिया इन्फेक्शंस बट माइंड यू that it is started after 1 year of chronic transfusions or the other indication is when the ferritin level is greater than 1000 nanogram per deciliter. The oral drug deferiprone 20 milligram per kg per day is an alternative to the desferioxamine. The ascorbic acid causes increased excretion of the iron in the urine. So you advise the patient that use the foods containing vitamin C or ascorbic acid so that the iron is excreted in the urine. And also you offer the patient folate as a supplement which helps in development of the RBCs. The final treatment when the requirements of the transfusions become more frequent, you have to go to the splenectomy. The indications are that the transfusion requirements increase 50% in 6 months and packed cell transfusion per year 250 cc per kg and there is severe leukopenia or thrombocytopenia. The complications and emergencies, the patient may suffer from sepsis. The sepsis is usually with the encapsulated organisms. Though there are many encapsulated organisms, pneumococci, meningococci, E. coli and Haemophilus influenzae, but in splenectomy cases, these four ones are of prime importance: meningococci, streptococci, Haemophilus influenzae and influenza virus. These are very crucial and they attack the patient more commonly. That is why when you go for the splenectomy, their vaccination of these four or against these four organisms which I have mentioned earlier, they are preemptively given to the patient. Now the other complication after sepsis is cardiomyopathy, which presents with chronic heart failure, and you treat the patient as you treat a patient of chronic heart failure with the diuretics, digoxin and deferoxamine as a chelating agent. The endocrinopathies, the patient may present to you with the diabetic ketoacidosis. Take care during hydration so as not to precipitate chronic heart failure from fluid overload. It means that the person who presents to you with diabetic ketoacidosis, he might also be suffering from the chronic heart failure because of the myopathy involvement with the iron deposition. So take care. The immunizations before the splenectomy are are carried out against meningococcal vaccine or pneumovax or pneumococcal organism, Hib type or Haemophilus influenzae organism, and annual influenza vaccine. Follow for signs of diabetes, hypothyroidism, and gonadotropin deficiency, and also keep in mind that the growth hormone deficiency may also be a feature of the patient suffering from beta thalassemia, and because of the iron deposition in the pituitary gland, the patient might also suffer from the growth hormone deficiency and similarly the gonadotropin deficiency. So follow for signs of cardiomyopathy or chronic congestive heart failure. And similarly, check the hepatic dysfunction frequently, get done the LFTs, and also check with the ultrasound. The patient may be suffering from, patient may be having hepatomegaly because of the iron deposition or hemochromatosis. The patient might also be suffering from osteoporosis. Prevent it with the diet and exercise, hormone supplementation, and also by offering the patient the osteoclast inhibiting medications, which are bisphosphonates. And always keep on checking the ferritin levels of the beta thalassemia major patients. On the drugs of which has been used in the West with some help, the oral chelating agent is ethylene diamine. It is a pharmacologically regulating, upregulating gamma globin synthesis. It increases the gamma globin synthesis, and it also increases the hemoglobin F. It carries oxygen better than the hemoglobin A2, and also helps bind the alpha globin and decreases the precipitation of the alpha globins, which are actual culprits in the beta thalassemia. And the final authoritative treatment is bone marrow transplantation, which is histocompatibly matchable or allogenic stem cell transplantation. Now, gene therapy is also of tremendous value by inserting healthy genes into the stem cells and then transplanting into the patient. This is the advanced treatment being undertaken in many parts of the world, including Pakistan. Now, differential diagnosis, most commonly the iron deficiency anemia, in which there is MCV is low, iron is low, ferritin is low. In thalassemia, iron is high and ferritin is high. And all other hemoglobinopathies should also be taken into account in addition to the beta thalassemia or alpha thalassemia. And those one are, say, hemoglobinopathy E, hemoglobinopathy Concept Spring, which I will be showing you in the later slides. And finally, the iron deficiency anemia with polycythemia vera, in which there is microcytic anemia with normal or elevated red cell count. And finally, the anemia of chronic disease and macrocytic anemias will also fall into the category of differential diagnosis of beta thalassemia major. Signs. Now you see this patient having a normal skin color, and this patient is having both anemia as well as yellow discoloration of the hand, meaning thereby that the patient is having both anemia and jaundice. Now in the imaging, you see there is in this patient an X-ray showing that there is frontal bossing because of the cranial bone thickening and overgrowth of the zygomatic bone, and this patient is also having jaundice, and X-ray demonstrate expansion of the diplo, and this is the hair on end appearance, which is a classical hallmark X-ray of the beta thalassemia major. Now these are the over expansion of the anterior ends of the ribs, and the what is it? It is actually the extramedullary hemoptysis going on in the ribs. Now, as I said earlier, there are the other varieties of hemoglobin, may be hemoglobin S, which is alpha 2, beta 2, and S. It is a sickle cell anemia. Hemoglobin C, this results from a mutation in the beta globin gene and is a predominant hemoglobin found in people with hemoglobin C. It is a mild disease and not very important, but you have to remember it for the differential purpose. And similarly, the hemoglobin E, this variant results from mutation in the hemoglobin beta chain. People with hemoglobin E disease have a mild hemolytic anemia and mild splenomegaly, and it is found in Southeast Asia. Hemoglobin constant spring, this is very famous one, but rare disease, and it was detected or found first time in a Chinese family in the district of Jamaica of West Indies. In this variant, there is a point mutation in the alpha globin gene, producing an alpha chain that is abnormally long. Once again, listen carefully, that the alpha globin chains are longer than the normal length of the alpha globins. Both the messenger RNA and the alpha chain proteins are unstable. But unfortunately or fortunately, we haven't seen the hemoglobin constant spring disease in Pakistan. But for theoretical purpose, we must know it. The hemoglobin H or B4, this is a tetramer composed of 4 beta globin chain. It occurs only with extreme limitation of alpha chain availability. Hemoglobin H forms in people with 3 gene alpha thalassemia, as well as in people with the combination of 2 gene deletions, alpha thalassemia and hemoglobin constant spring. Hemoglobin BART, my word, this is a lethal disease. All gamma chains with 4 gene deletions, alpha thalassemia, no alpha chain is produced. The gamma chains produced during fetal development, they combine to form a gamma chain tetramer. Gamma chain tetramer, I again repeat, gamma chain tetramer. Individuals with 4 gene deletions, thalassemia, and consequent hemoglobin BARTs, they die in utero. My word, this is a deadly disease, Hydrops fetalis. Now, the sickle cell disease, it is an autosomal recessive disorder commonly found in Africa. The hemoglobin is abnormal, and commonly the patients present with the vaso-occlusive crisis. The amino acid substitution is at point number 6, where valine replaces the glutamic acid, and there is production of hemoglobin S instead of hemoglobin A. The homozygote type is SS, and heterozygous variety is HBAS or HBSC. And HBSAS variety is known as sickle cell trait. It is a milder disease, but homozygous variety, SS1, it is a severe disease. But the sickle cell anemic patients, by luck, have got a protection from the falciparum malaria, but it has a sickling, may have a sickling experience because of the hypoxia. Pathogenesis: hemoglobin S polymerizes when deoxygenated. RBC deform, they become sickle shaped. They are very fragile, and they hemolyze very easily, and they block the small blood vessels. On laboratory examination, the hemoglobin level will be 6 to 9 gram per deciliter, and the reticulocyte count is very high, as high as 20% of the reticulocytes count may be found in the peripheral blood film. The patient will also be having unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia, and the film will show sickle cell targets as well as the target cells. The other important test is sickle solubility test, which is also will be fluoridely positive in cases of sickle cell anemia. The finally, the HB electrophoresis will be a confirmatory test in which the pattern may be found HBSS, HBAS, HB variants, and the cord blood diagnosis for pneumococcal vaccination. So you can diagnose the disease in the embryonic stage of this disorder, the help of the cord blood. Signs and symptoms: chronic hemolysis, well tolerated, but the crises are not. The vaso-occlusive painful crises are the present in a severe form. There is microvascular occlusion, bone marrow is affected. The patient may have severe bony pains, which is triggered by cold, hypoxia and dehydration, as well as with the infections. The patient may present to you with hand and foot syndrome, and the less than 3 years old patients may present with the hand and foot syndrome, and the patient may present with dactylitis. The patient also may present to you with acute abdomen because of the occlusion of the mesenteric vessels. Now, the CNS infarction, the 10% of the children may suffer from it, and they may present to you with the stroke, with the seizure, or with the cognitive impairment or defects. Now, transcranial Doppler ultrasonography indicates the risk of stroke in patients of sickle cell anemia. Transfusion of the blood reduces hemoglobin synthesis, averts the risk, and AVA similarly, it averts the risk of the stroke. Now, the another crisis is avascular necrosis of the femoral head. The patient may also have leg ulcers, and patient may also present to you with the priapism, or popularly known as low flow priapism, and the treatment is with the hydration and with the alpha agonist agents and phenylephrine. Now, the patient also can present to you with the aplastic crisis, and parvovirus is the offending agent. There will be sudden reduction in RBC production. Sequestration crisis. There will be splenic atrophy, and there will be pooling of blood in the spleen and liver, and the patient may present to you with the organomegaly along with anemia. The patient may also present to you with the shock and requiring urgent transfusion to save the life of the patient. Now, the triggers told earlier: hypoxia, dehydration, infections, and leading on to the changes in the body temperature. With dehydration, the acidosis results in a shift of oxygen dissociation curve. The diagnosis is with the help of the HB electrophoresis. You will be finding HBS, HBSC, HBS beta plus thalassemia on HB electrophoresis. The complications of sickle cell anemia are splenic infarction. It occurs in the children more commonly because of the microvascular occlusion, and secondly, the infections can also occur. There will be poor growth, and the patient will also be suffering from chronic renal failure, or the patient may have gallstones, retinitis, or retinal damages, and patient will also be having iron overload as in the beta thalassemia. The lung damage leads to hypoxia, and hypoxia leads to the fibrosis, and fibrosis culminates in the development of the pulmonary hypertension. So the patient may present to you with the right heart failure. My word, remember that the patient presenting to you with the right heart failure might be a case of sickle cell anemia. Prevention of the sickle cell anemia is genetic counseling, prenatal tests, and parental education, and it can prevent as much as 90% of the deaths. So the education of the parents has a huge benefit. Now these are the sickle cells, these are the normal cells. These sickle cells, they are trapped in the small vessels and sequestered in the spleen. They have the poor capability as told earlier. Management of sickle cell disease. Hydroxycarbamide is frequent crisis. I mean the high production of hemoglobin F. So, and there is, if there is splenic infarction and hyposplenism. Give antibiotics and immunizations. There is risk of septicemia. Admit the patient, give antibiotics. Criteria is that if the hemoglobin is less than 5 gram per deciliter or WBC count is less than 5,000 or more than 30,000 and the temperature of the patient is 40 degrees centigrade and the patient has got pain crisis, the patient is dehydrated, there are lung infiltrates on the x-ray, then treat the patient urgently, imminently, immediately with the BMT, meaning thereby the bone marrow transplantation. Any questions you can ask, it will be a happy welcome. I will enjoy your question and I will like to answer your questions. Thank you very much. Please don't forget to send me a feedback because the online teaching is an interesting, amazing, amusing challenge to all of us, and I want to adopt it as a profession, and because it is, to me, it is very romantic to teach on the online. Okay, my dear students of fourth year MBBS, I will be waiting for your feedback. Okay, goodbye from Akhtar Syed Trust Hospital.